Well, first, a tangled tale of an email too far. This is it here. Never seen the light of day before. This was something that was sent to me almost a year ago on Saturday, October the 11th last year, a few weeks after the Scottish referendum. And what it is an email from a Treasury official 1 week before the referendum on the 10th of September 2014 at 10:15 and 34 seconds. Now, the timing is very significant because this email tells recipients in the BBC that a Treasury source is saying, quote, as you would expect, RBS, the Royal Bank of Scotland, have been in touch with us and have similar plans to base themselves in London. That was sent to the BBC just in time for the 10 o'clock news, and it duly appeared in these terms on the BBC programme. The problem was, of course, that the Royal Bank of Scotland meeting, which was discussing that, didn't finish till 25 minutes after that email was sent. So in other words, the Treasury were leaking Royal Bank of Scotland plans before they even made the decision, and the BBC dutifully reporting them. And so by the time in the next morning that the chief executive of the Royal Bank of Scotland, Ross McEwan, sent an email around his staff saying, look, this is not about moving our headquarters, it's a technical matter affecting the registration of our head office, moving a brass plaque, not jobs or investment, then the bird had already flown and the story was all over the place, led, of course, by the BBC. Now, this email is an example of the dirty tricks that were going on in the referendum campaign. First, because the Treasury were meant to be bound by the so-called Purdah rules. That was in the Edinburgh Agreement on Clause 29, that the UK government and its civil servants were meant to stay impartial, as they do in a normal election campaign during the referendum period. And this email, this one, is part of a trail of emails now exposed for freedom of information, which shows that far from doing that, Treasury officials were busy briefing hostile information to the Yes campaign, breaching any semblance of Purdah rules. It's why, incidentally, that the government were turned over in the House of Commons just last week, because MPs of all sides don't want to see a repeat of this nefarious activity in the European referendum. But of course, there's a question then of the BBC, because they weren't just the unconscious recipients of this, they were the purveyors of this misleading information. And of course, then refused, or wouldn't, with a few honourable exceptions, do any research into where the leak of this information came in the first place. They just wanted to report the distortion of the news and not investigate who was manipulating the news. Now, is everybody in the BBC happy with this? Well, obviously people like Nick Robinson, the political correspondent, were extremely happy. They purveyed the news, the misinformation. But others weren't. That's why I got the email in the first place. So with some honourable exceptions, the BBC were acting as the agents of Treasury misinformation. I think the revelation of this right now is really important as we contemplate future referendum, either the European referendum to come next year or any future Scottish referendum. We have to make sure next time that things are played out fair and square. And the evidence for that is this email too far, an email too far for the Treasury and for the BBC.